Well, some schools in the U.S. looking more like juvenile detention centers. There's a growing trend of police officers patrolling school halls, and with that, more kids getting arrested. The biggest offense? Disrupting class. Now, this is going on mostly in Texas. Reports came out recently that a 12-year-old girl was arrested for spraying perfume on herself at a middle school in Austin. So swearing, smoking cigarettes, violating dress code, all these things can land kids a ticket to court. According to The Guardian, in 2010, police gave about 300,000 Class C misdemeanor tickets to children as young as 6 years old. So are these schools criminalizing normal childhood behavior? And how is this trend shaping our youth? To discuss this and more, Dr. Susan Phillips, research analyst for the Sentencing Project, joins me now. Welcome to the show, Susan.
Hi, Liz. Thanks for having me.
So, I mean, what do you think? Do you think childhood behavior is becoming more criminalized these days?
I think that's true, and I think it's part of a larger trend that we've seen in this country over the past 30 years to solve problems using the criminal justice system. So we see children in classrooms now with police monitoring their behavior, and rather than treating misconduct as part of a normal childhood behavior, we have police stepping in and arresting children or citing them as young as 6 years old. So these children are getting exposed to the criminal justice system earlier and earlier, so they get stigmatized by peers. In lockup facilities, they may learn even worse behaviors from other children. And we find that this group of children are more likely to drop out of school, which is one of the risk factors for people becoming involved in adult crime. And so we use the expression cradle to prison pipeline to describe this. And it is. We set kids up at an earlier and earlier age to be part of this, what we call a prison industrial complex.
And part of this cradle-to-prison pipeline is this zero-tolerance policy that is instated in a lot of public schools, and I wanted to bring that up here, exactly what this policy is. Schools rely on suspension, expulsion, citation, summonses, and arrests to handle disciplinary problems like bringing cell phones and iPods to school, smoking cigarettes, and skipping class. Students who might easily be disciplined through a visit to the principal's office end up in jail cells. This is the essence of the pipeline. And criminal charges are brought against youth in schools for violations that never would be considered criminal if committed by an adult. So, I mean, as you had mentioned before, these things, I mean, they're relatively, I mean, pretty minor. A lot of them are nonviolent. And then they end up in this prison system, this juvenile prison system. And then, I mean, how does that affect the rest of their life? I mean, in terms of going to college, getting a job, it kind of creates this vicious cycle.
It does. It pegs them and helps them think of themselves as criminal and bad. It may be totally ineffective in addressing whatever the underlying problems are with the child or in the child's family or in the child's community that have led to disruptive behaviors. So we see these children being more likely to drop out of school, not finish school, not get jobs, to begin hanging out more and more with other children that feel separated from the mainstream. And it's part of the process of criminalizing children, of feeding them into the adult system.
And I did, not too long ago, I interviewed a young man who he spent time with the juvenile detention, juvenile justice system, and because of that, as a minor, he ended up in the adult prison system. I want to play a clip where he describes his experience there.
In my eyes, it wasn't designed to rehabilitate you. It was designed for punishment, you know, having barbed wires around the gate, and it's just preparing you for more criminal type of lifestyle.
And I want to talk more about that. I mean, when you're put into this situation, how that prepares you for a more criminal type of lifestyle where it's not rehabilitative, but in fact harmful.
Well, that's true. And so the first problem is that it's possibly a missed opportunity to intervene. As the young man said, it's not rehabilitative. Many of the programs that we see aren't effective. They might address problems or try to address problems the child's having, but they don't also try to address problems that the family's having or that problems that the community's having. And then we know that on top of that, the fact that children and adults becoming involved in the criminal justice system helps to perpetuate problems. We know from the adult system that, particularly in communities where there's high levels of incarceration, that feeds the very problems that are associated with crime and offending. It feeds disruptions in families. It feeds poverty. It feeds single-parent households. And so we have this perverse situation whereby using the criminal justice system to address problems, we're also creating the situations that could continue to create a need for the criminal justice system unless we step back and say, what else is it that we can do? Unfortunately, we're beginning to see some states looking at the huge amount of money that's being spent in their state budgets on corrections, saying maybe we could take some of that money and put it back into communities and families and children and not spend it on high-cost detention beds and prison beds and actually get some better outcomes.
And, you know, it seems, especially in the state of Texas, it seems like there is this focus to expand law enforcement. And this expansion is expanding into schools, into middle schools, into high schools. How did that happen? I mean, where did the mentality shift from education to discipline?
Oh, if it were only Texas. But it's a number of states. Los Angeles is probably the leader in it. And I think you have to go back about 40 years to the beginning of the war on drugs and this idea that we could take what is arguably a public health problem and deal with it through the correction system. And we've continued to do that in a number of ways. And so putting police officers into schools as what might have been a preemptive move has just expanded the use of the criminal justice system to solve problems that they can't solve and in some cases make worse.
And even just, I guess, the beginning of this trend here, putting police officers in schools, the expansion of this practice, I mean, when you put armed police officers patrolling the schools, I mean, that has to do something to affect the learning environment and the mentality of the kids that go to school, where it's supposed to be this more nurturing learning environment. But I can imagine this affects, you know, the mindset of students to see this.
Right. Think about how that shapes a child's identity when in your school, in your community, what you see constantly is the police being present and stepping in. And everybody you know being, or many people that you know, being arrested and sent into the criminal justice system, often for fairly low-level crimes. I mean, what message does that send? But that, gosh, that's what my future holds for me. And it can become a self-fulfilling prophecy for kids.
Right. And I want to talk, you did touch upon it a little bit earlier. What are the alternatives to this? As opposed to, you know, criminalizing kids and putting them through the justice system at such a young age. I mean, what are the more effective approaches to you know, handling children that might be
misbehaving,
you know, kids being kids, you know, maybe violating the dress code, throwing paper airplane. I mean, you know, kids are kids. So what's a better way to deal with kids, whether it be rehabilitative or counseling? What is the better approach?
I'm hopeful. I think first what people have to do is take a look at the schools in their communities and see the extent to which this is happening, 6-year-olds to be arrested and cited. And then I think they have to work together with school principals and community groups to first get a commitment to stop citing kids for these misbehaviors. And then I think there's any number of ways that schools can instead begin to engage parents in supervising children and addressing problems, the root causes of the problems. Is it learning disabilities that the kids are not attentive in school? Do they just need some coaching on other behaviors? And so I think in terms of a process rather than an end result of engaging community groups, confronting and engaging their schools and their police forces.
All right. And lastly, just want to ask you, I mean, what can be done to kind of reverse this mentality of expanding the policing of schools to a more rehabilitative approach, which studies show is more effective and a healthier approach?
So I think programs like this, where people realize this is happening, is a big first step. And I think we'll see attitudes reversing And we're seeing this in a number of places because it's become so widespread. It's not just somebody else's children anymore. It's shocking for parents to find out that the police are intervening with their children for something that in days gone by might have just been a telephone call from a teacher. So the more widespread it is, the more alert people are, the more they question, the more likely we are to see change.
All right, Susan, thank you so much for coming on the show and weighing in on this very important topic. We are out of time. That was Dr. Susan Phillips. She's a research analyst for the Sentencing Project. Well, some schools in the U.S. looking more like juvenile detention centers. There's a growing trend of police officers patrolling school halls. And with that, more kids getting arrested. The biggest offense, disrupting class. This is going on mostly in Texas. Reports came out recently that a 12-year-old girl was arrested for spraying perfume on herself at a middle school in Austin. So swearing, smoking cigarettes, violating dress code, all these things can land kids a ticket to court. According to The Guardian, in 2010, police gave about 300,000 Class C misdemeanor tickets to children as young as 6 years old. It's being called the War on Kids, and a documentary by that title takes a close look at a school system growing more authoritarian and paranoid. Here's a sneak peek.
It's like we take our children and we lock them up in a prison for 13 years of their life.
If you're in summer, you're like, oh man, you're like so free and you're happy and everything's fun. And then you go to school and nothing is good anymore.
Well, the director of that film, The War on Kids, Kevin Soling, joins us now. Welcome, Kevin. So tell us more about your film and what inspired you to make it.
Well, what inspired me to make the film was basically I was seeing more and more incidents of zero tolerance being used to expel and suspend children for the most ludicrous of infractions. Things like kids would have a chicken strip and point it at another student and say, pow, and they'd be suspended for possessing a weapon or making a threat. Kindergartners playing cops and robbers, using their fingers as guns and saying bang, and the principal suspending those children. And these would be, you know, kindergartners, 5 and 6 years old. And this just seemed to be this growing trend throughout the nation. And it was extremely disturbing to me. And I thought attention should be drawn to this.
Now, this harsh response, a lot of it could be attributed to this zero tolerance policy that is instated at schools across the country. I wanted to take a look at at a piece of this policy some schools might abide by. Schools rely on suspension, expulsion, citations, summonses, and arrests to handle disciplinary problems, like bringing cell phones and iPods to school, smoking cigarettes, and skipping class. So criminal charges are brought against youth in schools for violations that never would be considered criminal if committed by an adult. So, Kevin, I mean, is childhood, normal childhood behavior becoming criminalized?
Not only is it becoming criminalized, it's becoming pathologized as well. You have 3 million children who are being diagnosed with ADD and other types of psychological issues for what is essentially normal childhood behavior.
And kind of taking a look at what, you know, one thing leading to another, you know, when kids get charged, how does it affect the rest of their lives? I mean, it's happening at such a young age, yet, I mean, in terms of going to college and getting a job, that stigma of already being, you know, having that run-in with the law, I mean, how does this kind of set the tone for the rest of their lives?
Well, one of the things that's always amazed me is every time I show my film and I'm present at the screenings, people come up to me afterwards with their own stories of injustice that just stayed with them since they were little. And these would generally be sort of trivial things, but it always stuck with them. And I think about that in terms of these much more dramatic situations where a girl scribbles on her desk in a marker and is taken away by the police as a result of this, something that's easily to be cleaned off. And I know to the degree that these instances of injustices stay with people, that it leads to distrust of authority and general apathy and antisocial attitudes in general.
Now, I want to get back to kind of the root of this trend that we're seeing of police officers patrolling the halls of middle schools and high schools. I mean, just to have that police presence there, armed police officers patrolling your schools, I mean, that has to do something to the mentality and to the learning environment within these schools.
Yeah, the students I spoke to generally felt as if they were in prison. They recognized it was a prison environment. They felt very paranoid. The cameras definitely increased that sense of paranoia. I spoke with students at Columbine, and one of the things that basically is taking place is that cameras have been placed throughout many, many high schools throughout the country in response to Columbine, but the cameras were actually in Columbine prior to the shootings that took place there. And no one questions whether the cameras were a contribute to that, the psychology of what caused these kids to explode. But they generally resent and feel, you know, the perpetual surveillance that they're under.
And I mean, Kevin, how do we get to this point? I mean, education is supposed to be, you know, this stimulating this learning environment, preparing kids for the adult world. I mean, when did it shift from education to this more culture of discipline?
Well, education by its nature, at least public schools as they're defined, always was fundamentally problematic. And if you look at the proficiency in writing, it's 13% of the country, of the United States. So schools have always failed. They've never been very good at educating, and this is sort of a continued trend. And the problem is that schools are governed by social efficiency, which means that they have to process large numbers of people, and they can only do this if they are an autocratic institution. And their primary means of creating stability is suppressing dissent. What I think the transformation that took happened was that we went from a homogeneous population in these schools to a heterogeneous one. And so where you have a common culture in school, where everyone sort of comes from the same background, it's easier to suppress and keep people in line. But when people have different cultures, greater efforts have to be made to basically keep people in line and enforce the conformity that is demanded and required in public schools. They're not good places to learn, and they're not good places to be.
Now, I know that you say schools, I read that you say schools, they're not healthy environments. Kids are deprived of almost all civil rights. I mean, what do you mean by that? And when kids are repressed, how can we expect them to react?
Well, that's, you know, what I outlined in the War on Kids. I showed that this is a terrible problem. There was a landmark Supreme Court case that was actually touted as a defense for the rights of students, which was Tinker versus Des Moines, where the petitioners were allowed to wear black armbands. But the only reason they were allowed to wear black armbands was that they met several guidelines, that they were quiet and passive, they were not disruptive, and they didn't infringe on the rights of other students. So that is basically the guidelines for the, you know, how students may behave, how they can even express their First Amendment rights is severely restricted. But they can be searched and seized at any time. There are strip searches that have been done, and I know there was a court case that sort of called question to that, but that was only because they were searching for aspirin instead of illegal drugs, and the case might have been ruled differently if that were the case. And they're deprived of Miranda rights. They really do not have civil rights in school, and this environment, which is essentially fascist environment, is what they grow up in and experience, and they really are not aware of what their civil rights are. And there have been studies that have shown that they basically expect the government to review things in the press before 49% of high school students said that it was appropriate for government to review media before, you know, and censor it if necessary. This is very disturbing, and this is what that comes out of being in that kind of environment.
Now, so, you know, this environment, it seems unfair, unproductive. It just doesn't seem, it doesn't seem like it's a good system, like almost like we're failing our kids here in the U.S. I mean, as opposed to this approach, what would be a more effective approach in terms of dealing with kids, whether it's rehabilitation or counseling? What are the better alternatives?
A better alternative is basically a system where students are allowed to pursue their interests. I mean, one of the primary things that takes place in school, the very first lesson, and you may not pursue whatever it is you're interested in. We have a curriculum, and we're not even going to, you know, whatever is interesting or potentially interesting in this curriculum will be taken out. There can't be anything controversial in curriculum. So whatever is there is just a facade anyway. So students, you know, children must be permitted and allowed to study what they're interested in and have mentors and not be placed in an environment where they are deprived of pursuing, you know, what it is that they enjoy. Learning is subverted into something that children resent, not because of their own desires and drives, but because of the institution itself.
All right, Kevin, a very interesting topic, and thank you so much for coming on the show. That was Kevin Solling. He's the director of the documentary The War on Kids.